Hi guys, hi VC. Thank you for tuning in. This video is especially for you, John. You started the thread, the final hype. Is it a good thing or is it a bad thing? And you can look at this in many different ways. This discussion has many angles. For me personally, I say 100% it's a good thing. And of course, I say that also to have a little bit of an open discussion. But I will try to convince you. I've pulled out an stack of records from my collection to see if I can convince you. Let's start at the end of the last hype. So, 1991, you could buy a record of Seal in your local record shop. If you heard a song on the radio, Joyride for example, you could buy the album of Roxette. Same goes if you liked Lenny Kravitz, you could go to the local record shop and buy this record. You could buy it on CD, or you could buy it on vinyl, your own preference. But this ended abruptly. 1992, this was almost impossible. At that time, I was also involved in acid jazz. It was a style I liked very much. So these kind of records were still available. Incognito, for example. This one is from 1995. But this whole genre stopped a little bit, or it moved into another direction. So it was fun to go to my collection and see what is the last pop album I bought. It turned out to be Lauryn Hill. This one is from 1998. And I like to play my music on vinyl. Somehow, putting on the needle, the whole experience, it brings me emotionally closer to the music. That's the way I prefer to have to listen to my music. So I had to look in different ways to see and find vinyl, and it pushed me a little bit in the direction of electronic music, dance music. At that time, this is 2000, this was still readily available. Dance music was pressed a lot on 12 inches and complete albums like Victor Davis, for example. And you had also Kyoto Jazz Massive. So that was a little bit of a good thing. The vinyl was not readily available, but it pushed me that I had to search for it, and I discovered genres I didn't know, but I liked them very much. For example, a record label that I discovered was Schema, and Nicola Conte brought out his vinyl, brought out his albums on vinyl, and I think he did it because he loved vinyl. He's inspired by the music from the 60s, jazz from the 60s, so he brought out also his albums on vinyl. I think the same goes for this label, Ricky Tick, which was a new label to me. They also brought out their albums on CD and vinyl, which was a good thing. But it was not easy to find vinyl. One of the labels was Soul Brother Records. It was not really a label, it was a shop in London, who is specializing in soul music and jazz music. And I must say respect to them. They brought out music on vinyl, I think, just because they loved it. They did not want it to go away. And Lawrence Pracknell is the owner of the shop, and I say big respect to you. He brought out compilations, and he also reissued some rare groove albums, like 100% Pure Preocean. And this brought me also and made me discover rare groove music. It was very fun. And it was possible to buy some pop records at that time. I bought, for example, Joss Stone. And I don't know why EMI brought it out, but I guess somebody somewhere in the record company said, you have to put this on vinyl. I don't know. I hope that's the truth. But for some reason, it was brought out and I could buy it. Another album which was brought out, because this was released in 2004, and in 2005 Mariah Carey was releasing also albums on vinyl. And sorry that I made this decision to buy this, but at that time I got every week a small list from the distributor what was released in that week. It was a short list on A4, and also Mariah Carey was mentioned there, so I picked it up. It's actually quite fun that I picked it up, because if you look at Discogs, what this is worth now, it's of what people are willing to pay for it, it's funny. At that time I was also collecting, of course, second-hand albums, and I picked up, for example, Johnny Hammond Gears, and now people are paying more for this album than an original Johnny Hammond Gears album. I mean, how funny is that? But this was a turning point. This was 2005, I guess, and things were starting to change. A little bit later, for example, also Jamiroquai released his albums on vinyl again. And the same goes for Johnny Legend and The Roots. We are now already in 2010. But a lot of artists were releasing albums again on vinyl. You really saw that picking up. And also the interest in older albums, reissues, got started. And I mean, you could, for example, Can't Ramp. And I think everybody falls for this trap. 180 grams, high definition premium virgin vinyl, pressing for super fidelity. You can better leave this album in the cover. I mean, it's not that great. But it was a turning point, because you also saw the issues of much higher quality. For example, Placebo was released. This was done during Record Store Day. It was an exclusive for that day. Turned out it wasn't. Later on it is repressed, but I don't mind. It was a good thing. Even the represses, I'm okay with it. Thumbs up, because the more people get to know this music, the better. But Record Store Day also showed that it was getting more marketing got involved and more commercial things came out. But it was a good thing. I mean, look at this. Donny Hathaway just released. This is, I believe, an unreleased album, and it is now on vinyl for the very first time. A couple of years back, this was impossible. You could not believe that this was possible. But this is not true for all genres. If you look at this copy of T3 Corporation, dance music, electronic dance music, that's really... the hype is not there. I mean, look at how it is packed. It was a poster with some general cover, two albums inside. It was cheaply made, but luckily it was still pressed. The same you can see, for example, with Lord Echo. John, you recommended it. It is a limited edition, 300 were pressed. I was late. I mean, I think I bought it 6 months, maybe 9 months after it was released, and I have number 247 of 300 worldwide. That's incredible, and not many are released. But from other albums, many were pressed. For example, D'Angelo got pressed a lot of times. Marcus Miller got an album out. But what you see, and especially on this one, prices were getting higher and higher. This one I paid more as $30 just to get this one. And this made me think, are the record companies happy that vinyl is coming back? I don't think so. I don't think they are very happy at all. I think they were very happy to get rid of the pressing plant, the storage room, the distribution, the returns they got, the handling. I think digital was very easy for them. And now, because of the vibe that is coming back, they have to bring in third parties for the pressing and so on. So, to get the same margin, they have to increase the prices. Maybe somehow it's logical, we have to live with it. But maybe there's a solution. I like the way Earth Wind & Fire or Legacy Sony, who brought it out, solved this one. I think they did the complete digital side, and they left everything concerning the vinyl over to music on vinyl. It is not mentioned on the cover, also not on the sleeve inside. But if you look closely, I don't know if you can see this, but it says MOV LP 800 something, 895. And that means it is pressed at Record Industry and distributed by Music on Vinyl. And I guess they made it completely. They also did the cover, they pressed it, and they did the distribution for the vinyl side. This can maybe be a solution for the bigger companies. Because vinyl is here, there is a hype. I mean, look at the different obscure library records I've been able to buy. I mean, it's insane. And they are pressed in low quantities. But I think because of the hype, now there are so many records being pressed that also the pressing plants make a little bit more money, and they are able to do the maintenance on these, maybe update the pressing machines. And this is a big point, because I think, because this is happening, the pressing plant is the most important part. As long as that is available, that they are able to make a final, we will be in a good spot. But to make this happen, you have to have a lot of albums being bought. I mean, also for the mastering, you need the knowledge. New people need to come in, not only to buy the final, but also need to come in to those pressing plants to learn how you have can make records and how you make a good record. So I think that's a very important thing, and that's why I think that independent of the genre, as long as vinyl is being sold, this is a good thing. And it helps also for smaller productions like this, which is 500 units, that it can be able to be made. Another great example, for example, is Chelsea Wilson. This is made completely independent. She produced it, and I think she also has her own label. She's in Australia, and I got it here, I could buy it here locally. So I don't know if distribution was easy or not, but it is amazing that in this day and age, this is possible. I mean, how great is this, that you're living somewhere on the other side of the world, you think, I'm going to make some music, and I want to have it on vinyl. I think she used some crowdfunding to make it actually happen, but it was possible. She could produce it, she could make the music, and put it out on vinyl, so you could buy, anybody could buy it worldwide. I mean, this is the future. If this is the future, it's great. Because it means that any genre, anyone can make his own music and put it out on vinyl. As long as there is a hype and a request for vinyl, of course. Because there is one, I have my personal request. It's probably a dirty word, but smooth jazz. I am being able to find only one record being released from 2000 to 2016 on vinyl. And I bought it from Brian Culberson himself for the management, because he also released it on vinyl. I think somewhere in his heart he thought, I should make an album. But I think maybe his very first album was on vinyl, I'm not really sure. When this is possible, I mean, it's a great example, like Chelsea, that we are going in the right direction. But we need everything to work, and I think the key is the pressing plant. So that's my contribution to the discussion. I hope you liked it, John. I hope your shop goes very well, that you are very busy, I heard. So that's a good thing, and I hope because of the hype, you'll be a wealthy man. Thanks for watching, everybody. Take care. Goodbye.